Usually, a gate will be made from two standard livestock gates attached bottom to bottom to make a tall gate, so you'll need to assemble it at the fencing site. Start by laying them on a flat surface, bottom to bottom. Most fences arrive with the hinge pins attached for compact shipping. You'll need to remove them because they are usually not in their correct positions. After you've removed the pins from the gate, remove one nut and the two washers from each hinge pin. Then turn the remaining nut to the bottom of the threads. You may need a wrench to finish this job. Now put the washers back on the bolt and turn on the other nut a short way just to keep the parts all together until you install the gate. Do the same with the other three hinges. Now loosen the hinge brackets and position them halfway between two of the gate's crossbars. Retighten the hinges just enough to keep them in place. You may need to adjust the hinge locations more later. Repeat this step until all the hinges have been moved. Now you can connect the two halves of the gate using a section of EMT conduit that will fit inside the gate tubes. The conduit needs to extend 6 inches on each side of the joint. You can also use a coupler that is designed for your gate's tubes. You may need to use a chisel and a hammer to remove burrs inside the gate tubes so the connectors will slide in the necessary distance. Once the couplers are in both tubes on one half of the gate, slide the two halves of the gate together. Next, use a power drill to install self-tapping screws to connect the gate to the couplers. Put two screws on each side of the splice, about 1 inch and 2 inches from the splice. After you've put a pair of screws in on each side of the two splices, flip the gate over and do the same on the other side of the gate. The last step is to drill 3/8 inch drain holes in the bottom of the gate. You may need to punch a dimple in the tube to make it easier to drill on the rounded surface. With your gate assembled, you can make accurate measurements for the gate opening. Now you're ready to start constructing your fence. To attach wire fencing and wires to corner posts and to other wires, you will use a simple wrap technique to tie off the wire. Hammer in a staple at the desired height on the outside of the corner post. Wearing gloves and eye protection, push the end of the wire through a wire staple and around the corner post. Cross the length of the wire with about 12 inches of the loose end. About 6 inches from the crossing point, bend the loose end of the wire at a right angle so it is parallel with the length of the wire. Now, use this right angle bend like a crank to wrap this end of the wire 4 times around the length of the wire. Next, bend the crank handle so it's at a right angle to the length of the wire. Crank the handle until the wire breaks off near the wrap of the wire. You might want to use a wire twisting hand tool to make tighter wraps. There is also a wire twister that attaches to a cordless electric drill. It can wrap the wire even faster. The first step is to lay out the fence on the site. Start by clearing a swath 10 feet on each side of the planned fence, removing trees and brush, and mowing it as close to the ground as possible. Use your plan to mark the spot where each corner post will be placed. For each corner, take a 6-inch by 16-foot post, measure 6 feet from the widest end, and mark it with a lumber crayon. This line shows how deep to bury the wide end of the post. Use the power auger to drill a 12-inch hole 6 feet deep in the location for each corner post. Be sure to wear a helmet, safety glasses, hearing protection, and gloves while working. Put the post in the hole, making sure it is set at the 6-foot line you marked. If it's too deep, add some backfill to reach the correct depth. Use a level to set the post plumb, especially on the outside, the wire side of the post. Backfill the hole with sand and gravel or crushed rock to hold the post plumb. Use tamping bars to compact the backfill material as every 12 inches is added. As an alternative, you can hire a crew with post-driving equipment to install the posts. The widest end of the post should be driven in, and backfilling should be done around each post as needed. After the corner posts are in place, put the spinning jenny with the coil of 12.5 gauge galvanized wire next to the first corner post. Pull out enough wire to reach the second corner post. Tie off the loose end of the wire at about 3 feet high on the second corner post. A partly driven wire staple will hold the wire to the outside edge of the post at this height. At the spinning jenny near the first corner post, spool off enough wire to reach the first corner post and cut off the wire. Stick the end of the wire into the ground temporarily next to the corner post to keep it from coiling up. From the spool of wire, take the loose end of the wire and tie it off on the first corner post. Use a staple to hold it at 3 feet high on the outside edge of the post. Cut off the wire, leaving a length that extends about 2 feet from the post. Feed the end of this short wire through the eyelet on a ratchet wire strainer. Tie off the wire. Next, take the end of the long wire that is tied to the second corner post and thread it through the hub of the strainer, bending a short, tight C in the wire so it hugs the strainer's hub. Use the strainer handle to wind up the wire until the guide wire is tight. Now that you have a guide for the line posts, you can start marking their locations. You should install a guide wire to mark each side of your fenced enclosure. Do not run a single wire around the entire perimeter. This will let you work more efficiently by having crew members install posts on one side while holes are being drilled on another.